So. Now we consider problem. We consider two sequences which are given by counter set, usual standard counter procedure. The first sequence is given by the midpoints of complementary intervals, which are enumerated in natural order, you see, in natural way. They are ordered in natural way. And the second sequence, it is right endpoints of these complementary intervals. Now, first of all, what we want to prove? We want to prove that these two sequences indeed are rather different in the sense that the first sequence, it is G delta, and second is not G delta. So once more, I want to repeat that I started the lecture. If we have a countable set, then of course it is F sigma, not always it is G delta. Sometimes we can cover, sometimes not. For example, here for A, we can do this rather easily, yeah? Why can we do this? Because we can, there exists open set G, it is just the sequence of intervals. G, it is n from 1 to infinity, and here a n minus epsilon n, a n plus epsilon n, that covers all the sets, yeah? And what is more, we can take in such a way that this set will be disjoint from the counter set, yeah? Such that we have that this G intersected to counter set is empty. Of course, we can do this, yeah? Because these are points from the complement to closed set, yeah? We can take epsilon 1 in this way, epsilon 2 in this way, etc., etc. So there is open set which will separate all these points, yes? And then we can take GK. GK, what is GK? Of course, it is the same as that stuff. It is union from 1 to infinity a n minus. But now we will divide this by 2k, or maybe by k, it's not so important. Yeah? By something it goes to 0. 2k, and here a n plus epsilon n, and here 2k. And clearly, that a, it will be intersection of the set gk. Of course, yeah? Because if we take any point, if you take this intersection for concrete point A1, then this intersection will give only one point, and the same for other point. So clearly we have one embedding, second embedding also is trivial. Okay? Please your objections or questions about this solution about for the set A. It is G delta. But we cannot do the same for point from the second sequence. Roughly speaking, why? Of course, again, not the proof. It's something, a kind of hint. Why? What is the difference? Because if we will try to do the same, if we try to do the same, take the first point, yes, and we take any small interval containing this point, then this small interval will have a lot of other points from the sequence B. Of course, because this point B, it is point of accumulation of the point from B, yeah? Do you see this, yeah? There are many other points of this B type, since the counter set has empty interior. And we will remove some intervals, and the right points of these intervals will be all inside of this small neighborhood. Okay, of course it's not the proof, yeah? But this is a kind of hint that illustrates the difference between A sequence and B sequence. And how to prove this? The category, this is only the, in my opinion, suitable arguments here, suitable method to prove this, to prove the fact. Now, there is what we want to show by contradiction. Now we want to show that B is not G delta. Yeah? By contradiction, B, it is G delta. If it is G delta, it means that B, it is the intersection of some set Gn from 1 to infinity. Yeah? Some open sets. Now, what will we do? Again, indeed, the same arguments that we applied in the previous lecture and we applied in this lecture pair of times. You see? Very similar arguments. Then, what can we do? We can take We can take G relatively open sets. We can take relatively open sets. That is sets which are open with respect to counter set. Yeah, that is, we will reduce the situation to counter set. Do you remember that we started the lecture yesterday considering some problem, yeah? Instead of interval 0, 1, we considered some another set X, which was rather small, but complete. By complete, it's not compact. We will do the same. Take now Gn C. It's not the complement. It is Gn intersected to C. To its counter set. C is counter set. We remember with you from the course of metric spaces, then it just means the set is open in C. Then set is open. It is open in C, yeah? That is, if you want to have open set in some subspace, just take intersection, that's enough. Okay, so this open set. Now, and we have clearly that B, it is G delta C. That is, it is G delta with respect to compact set C, with respect to new set. And now we take complement C minus B by De Morgan law. De Morgan laws, they work in any case. We will have that it is F sigma, of course, with respect to C again, yeah? So it is some countable union of closed with respect to C sets, okay? Now, what do we have? We have that C minus B, it is the union of some sets Fn, which are closed with respect to C from 1 to infinity. And by these arguments that we started, all the sets must have empty with respect to C interior. Empty with respect to C interior. We have that Fn C interior is empty. Is it clear or not? Because look, if you suppose that there is some interval, of course, interval in counter set. So there is some this counter set, yeah? And there is this interval. There is interval, which is completely inside of Fn, yes? Then what do we have? We have that here there are no points from B. But this B is dense, yeah? Since we understand with you that B is dense in C. Do you understand this, yeah? Since any point of counter set can be approximated by this right end points of these removed intervals. Okay? No objection to this. You see this, yeah? Now, since it is dense, but this is from the complement, the four interior is empty. Interior is empty. We have that C minus B is of the first category. Now, but B definitely of the first category, since B is a sequence. Any sequence is of the first category. Sequence is first category. B is of the first category. Therefore, we have that C is of the first category. Of course, counter set is first category on the line, but not of the first category in itself. Yeah? Since now we discuss the situation in counter set C. But we have that C is of the second category in itself. So once more, look at this method. We reduce the situation to Baer theorem, to arguments of Baer theorem, not for the line, but for some another maybe very small set, but of course the set must be complete. Okay? Please, your questions. So once more, very roughly speaking, these points are distant in a sense, yeah? Just in a sense that we can cover them by some open intervals, disjoint open intervals. But we cannot do this for B sequence. We cannot do this for B sequence, since it is dense in C. Okay. Now, I hope that's more than enough. And now, let's return to this definition, to the definition. So, what is the Borel sets? Thus, we have some examples. In these examples, we see that we have collection of open sets, and we have strict embedding. We have strict embedding to collection G delta, yeah? G delta. For example, this collection contains closed sets, yeah? Now, this will be inside of G delta sigma. This is inside of G delta sigma delta, etc., etc., and we can continue the line, yeah? What is interesting? Interesting and non-trivial fact that all these embeddings are strict. Okay? That is, we can find example from here, G delta set, which is not open, any closed set, yeah? We can find set from here. So let's show set, which is G delta sigma, but which is not G delta, okay? Firstly, I want to write that, of course, the same stuff we can do for closed sets, but now we have to start from sigma. It is sigma, now this is sigma delta, this is sigma delta, this is F, of course, F sigma delta sigma, etc., etc., etc. Or maybe, before these examples, immediately it's better to give a definition. So all this eventually, it will give us the collection of Borel sets. So what does it mean, Borel sets? Borel sets, we will denote this collection by this B, Borel sets, by definition. It is this, can be written in principle, as a kind of that one. It is G delta, sigma delta, etc., etc. We can use these operations not only finitely many, any finitely many times, but countably many times, okay? That is, if we can do with the sets, we can take any countable unions, any countable intersections, and we can do this countably many times. So we will have some collection. It is the same, since we have, not in a rather simple way, we have that any of this one contain that one. It is F, sigma, delta, sigma, etc., etc. But maybe more, it's better to define in the following way. It is the same as to write that B, it is the smallest sigma algebra. I give a definition of sigma algebra, yeah? That is collection of sets which is called with respect to taking of union countable unions and the complement sigma algebra containing G, or maybe, or F, yeah? Maybe it's enough to say containing intervals of the type minus A, for example, minus infinity A. Minus infinity A, since if we have this interval of that type for any A, then we can, using the complements, intersections, to construct any open set, and then any closed, etc., etc., okay? Therefore, there exists the smallest sigma algebra that contains all this stuff. This smallest sigma, it is just by definition collection of Borel sets. This smallest sigma algebra can be done in this way, this increasing set of, increasing sequence of collections. And now I want to continue with examples to show that this, that all embeddings, write this explicitly, all embeddings are strict. I mean, all embeddings of that form are strict. Once more, the fact is rather non-trivial, and let's consider just the example of the set, which belongs to this set, this one and this one, but does not belong to this one and that one. What can we do? Let's take the following set A. A, it is, for negative, we can take rational points. For positive, we can take irrational points. So let's take set of rational, R plus intersected to set of rational, yeah? On the right side. And R minus negative rational, minus set of rational. So we take here irrational, all irrational points. Here we take all rational points. So there is some set A. Then what we are ready to show now, we are ready to show that this set A belongs to G delta sigma, and at the same time, belongs to F sigma delta, but this set does not belong to G delta, and it does not belong to F sigma, yeah? Now, It's more or less clearly that it's not G delta, yeah? Why it's not G delta? Because we are rational. Rational are here, yeah? Because this set is G delta. This set is G delta, but this set is not G delta. Wait a minute. Yeah, it's not G delta. This set is not G delta. This is G delta, yeah? Because it's a set of rational, not G delta, as we proved with you. If this set is not, if you suppose that all of this them are G delta, yeah? And then it's easy to see that interval minus infinity, zero, it is G delta trivially. Then since it is algebra, it's not difficult to show that all of them are algebras. But of course not sigma algebras, okay? All of them are close with respect to taking of finite unions and finite intersections. They are rather trivial. Therefore, if you suppose that this F is G delta, then we intersect to this G delta, and then we will have that this G delta, but it's not G delta. In the same way, this it is not F sigma, okay? So it's not here, it's not here. But it's rather trivial from this set, yeah? Because we understand with you, we have to understand with you that this is, of course, G delta sigma, and set of rational also, and also it is from F sigma delta. This is trivial, because it is from F sigma, yeah? But this is also easy to see. It's not from G delta, but it's from G delta sigma, yeah? Because any singleton from G delta, just take singleton and cover by sequence of integrals, it's from G delta, and this is countable union of singletons, okay? By De Morgan law, we have that set of rational also from here, okay? So we have that this embedding is strict, this embedding is strict, okay? Now, it's difficult to give constructive or some good set of that form to show that this is strict, but indeed, no need to do this in the sense that In analysis, this appeared rather often, yeah? For example, very important set of points of function is continuous. Look at your homework, yeah? G delta set, yeah? As you will prove, yeah? This also you can meet in many situations. Also, I gave you some examples in the first homework, yeah? But these are interesting in theoretical sense, but up to me, I have not met some interesting in analytic sense set, which will belong to this one, but does not belong to that one. So, once more, for analysis, as usual, this is enough. This is enough, okay? But keep in mind that all these embeddings are strict. Now the very interesting question. What is very interesting question? Natural question, which you have to ask now. You have 1 minute while I erase the... You have 1 minute to ask interesting question.
It's not interesting,
but it should be intersection. Q is the intersection. Yeah, of course. Yeah, you're right. It's not interesting. It's not equation. It is correction. Yeah, you're right. This is intersection. Thank you. So, interesting question is the following. Look. We have a lot of Borel sets, as we understand with you, yeah? We have some chain, there are a lot of open sets, etc., etc. There is some chain, but it's interesting to compare. So what is B? B, it is some sigma algebra. This sigma algebra definitely is inside of the largest possible sigma algebra. It's better to write now R, since we consider with you Borel sets on the line, but in principle, of course, it can be done in any metric, indeed, in topological spaces. In many metric spaces, it can be done, yeah? So we have this sigma algebra, smaller sigma algebra containing open sets. This is the largest sigma algebra. It's interesting to compare these two collections, yeah? So how large is this collection B, yeah? Comparing to that one. And here we see with you that indeed, as usual and as before, typical set is not Borel. There is almost all sets are not Borel, but now not in the sense of category. Maybe it's possible to introduce some metric and they consider category here, but in the sense of cardinality. So please look. Indeed, it seems to me we discussed this in the previous course. I want to repeat these arguments. How to find cardinality of this collection? To calculate how many elements are in this collection. At the beginning, let's look at cardinality of the set of intervals minus infinity A if A belongs to real line. Yeah? So cardinality of this is just cardinality of real line trivially, yeah? There is one-to-one correspondence. So this is a cardinality of real line. By the way, let's denote this by omega 1. Since I don't know is it typical or not, but in many books cardinality of countable set is denoted by omega, and first uncountable cardinal is denoted by omega 1, okay? Now look, but this is only for dead intervals. From here, we can say that cardinality of set of open also omega 1. Why? Because any open set, we remember with you what is the Lindelöf theorem, that any open set, it is finite or countable union of disjoint open intervals, yes? ANBN, okay? Now, there are only omega 1 intervals of that type. It's easy to see if there is omega 1 intervals of that type, then definitely cardinality of this is the same, you see? But this countable union, it will not enlarge the cardinality, since this omega 1 is much larger than this omega, okay? Is it clear or not? That is, we will have omega 1, these open sets. But then, all these operations, if you look at that stuff, you see? Here again, we use only countably many operations. Only countable intersection, countable union, countable intersection, and eventually only countably many operations. Again, these countably many operations cannot enlarge the cardinality. And from here we have that cardinality of Borel sets also is omega 1. Of course, this is large in the sense that it's uncountable, but it's very small if we will compare with cardinality of this collection, of that set, of this collection. Why? Because I hope you understand that there is one-to-one correspondence if you consider the collection of all subsets of A, then it's not difficult, just in straightforward way, to arrange the one-to-one correspondence bijection between the any subset from here and the function, and functions that maps from set A into set of the functions that have only two values, 0 and 1. Just characteristic function, yes? If element belongs to this set, then it is 1, doesn't belong to 0, so definitely it is bijection, yeah? And cardinality of that stuff, again, it's easy to see, from here, cardinality of that stuff, it is 2, and here, cardinality of A. It's more or less clearly, yeah? Now look, the 4 from here, we have that cardinality of P of R, it is 2 omega 1. This is new cardinal, which is, of course, larger than this omega 1, yeah? Much larger. That is, once more, in the sense of cardinality, typical set on the real line is not Borel. There is typical set is not Borel. Borel sets, they form rather small subcollection, but natural equation show, please, explicitly one set which is not Borel. Yeah? We will do this with you later, but this using some other arguments. So, again, as with these nowhere differentiable functions, typical element does not have some good property, but it's difficult to show explicitly this element, okay? Okay, now, it seems to me that's enough. Please your questions about this subject. Okay, it's time to start new one. Okay. Borel sets 2-4. Now let's look at bare functions. This subject is rather close to the Borel sets, as we will see now with you. If Borel sets, it is some extension in natural way, extension of the concept of open set, yes? That Borel functions, it is extension of the concept of continuous function, yeah? So we have some set. For simplicity, let it will be interval. So we have x, okay, we have b, 0, which will be just set of, without loss of generality, let's consider interval 0, 1. So we have set of continuous function. Topology here is not very important, yeah? We consider this not as topological, not as a norm space, not as Banach space, just as collection of functions and nothing more, okay? This is B0. This is first bare class. This is first bare class. Or maybe it's better to write immediately bare at the beginning. We will do this, and then we'll write only B, since we have to avoid this misunderstanding with Borel sets. Now what is the bare one class? Bare one class, it is functions, f, such that there are pointwise limits of sequence of continuous function, such that there exists sequence fn from 1 to infinity, from this b0, bare 0, such that for any x, this is pointwise limit, we have that f of x, it is the limit with respect to n, fn of x, yeah? So, this is pointwise topology, pointwise convergence. We introduce some class bare 1. Of course, this is some set is larger, since it's easy to show function which is pointwise limit. Look, this function is pointwise limit of continuous functions, yeah? But it's not continuous. This function from bare 1. Now, we can continue this stuff. We will write the bare n plus 1 by definition. It is f such that there exists fk, such that, of course, from the previous class, from this class bare n, such that we have that fk convergence to f pointwisely. So we will do this step by step, yeah? And then, of course, we will have the same type chain. We have bare 0 inside of bare 1, etc., etc. Yeah. So we understand what is the bare functions now. Eventually, we will have that all of them are from class of bare function. Bare functions are functions that can be obtained in this way. Okay. And what is more, this, maybe it's not quite good, since we consider not only finitely many steps, we can consider infinitely countably many steps at all, also, the same as for this Borel sets, and we can write in this way. This is union, but this increasing union of bare alpha. Alpha, it is some cardinal, and here this smaller than omega 1. So we collect all together. We can do countably many of these operations. Now, if you will take the course 502 next semester, then we will consider this topology in more details. So this pointwise topology has some many disadvantages. For example, it's not metrizable, etc., etc. But it's very related to this, of course, to this class or collection of bare functions. And this is the smallest collection space space complete. Complete. It's not metric space. This topology is not metrizable. With respect to pointwise convergence, it is the smallest and containing, containing, of course, containing this C01. There is. We have space C01. We can consider topology, which is given by pointwise convergence. If you want, we can describe the neighborhoods of this topology, etc., etc. Yeah? This topology is not metrizable, but as any topological space, we can take completion of this space. Yeah? This space is not complete with respect to pointwise topology, as we see from this example. Okay? Now, and if we will take completion, we will have just this set, this space of bare functions, the space of bare functions on the interval 0, 1. Okay? So there is some analogy with this collection of Borel functions, and this analogy is much stronger than just from, we can say, see from this analog with these chains, as we will see with you now. But before this, I want to give you one interesting theorem. Again, without proof, but with some references, which shows that these two subjects are very, very related one to another. I mean, Borel sets and bare functions. But before this, maybe it's better to consider some examples at the beginning. And then I'd like to recall you some stuff about semi-continuous functions, since some arguments we will use with you in what follows. Okay. Some examples. Some trivial examples are the following. The first example, characteristic function of any interval, it is bare one definitely. Okay, maybe let's write a subscript. Okay, so if you take any interval, just interval, not for any set, not. There is open, closed, here, where I, it is maybe open, or half open interval, etc., etc. It's not difficult to see, okay? Bare one. The second simple example. If function, if let function be such that for any point C, wait a minute, yeah, that there exists derivative of the function, of this function at point, I think it's for any point, or there exists point, for there exists for any point. Okay, in this way. Now, yes. Yes, 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 for any point C. For any point C. Suppose that function is differentiable, but derivative may be of any type. Discontinuous, for example, as in Volterra example, yeah, that we discussed with you. Then what do we have? We have that this function from bare one class also. So bare class one contains all characteristic functions of intervals, in particular, derivative is better to write, since for function is not interesting. If derivative exists, then function is continuous, it's from bare zero class. But derivative, in general, is not continuous, yeah? So, once more, we remember, that in the first lecture, in the second lecture, we considered this Volterra example. In Volterra example, the derivative exists for any point, but derivative is discontinuous on set of positive measures. So it may be discontinuous for many points. Okay. Now, but this derivative must be of the class bare one. Why? By definition of the derivative. Indeed. Indeed. What is, since derivative exists for any point, what is f prime of c? F prime of c, it is the limit of n, and here c plus 1 over n minus f of c. Look, this is the definition of the derivative, yes? The function is continuous. The function is continuous, f, since it's differentiable. So we have this representation. Okay, now it would be great to finish this subject today. Okay, now what I want to say. I want to say the following, that this class any of this class is closed with respect to taking of the sum, difference, multiplying by coefficient, but of course it's not closed with respect to limits. Maybe it's closed with respect to uniform limit, but not definitely with respect to pointwise limit, since if you take pointwise limit, of course we will be in another class. So we can say the following. If Fn are from this bare k class, then we will have that upper limit of Fn, which always exists in extended sense, lower limit of Fn, they belong to bare k plus 1. It's not difficult, since this upper limit, it is just limit of supremum, yeah? Why? Since by definition, of course, this is pointwise limit, yes? Now, by definition, usual limit belongs to the next class, but this is upper limit. But upper limit, it is just usual limit. This is usual limit for n, and here we take supremum for k more or equal than n f k. But definitely supremum will be in the same class, not difficult to see. So this is limit, okay? So they are from the next class. Okay, and now I want to recall you, some stuff which is related to this subject. Since we will have some characterizations in terms of upper limit, lower limit. And what is more, the characterization of functions from that class can be done in terms of some Borel sets. So we will consider with you, I recall since definitely you met this before and you know upper and lower semi-continuous functions. So look, this function is lower semi-continuous, okay? And this function is lower semi-continuous. So what is there at this point, since at other points it's continuous. So what is important? What does it mean continuity of the function? We have that function is continuous if we have that limit exists. Limit exists and at this point, at point x0. And this limit when x goes to x0, this is limit fx. And this is the value of the function. Lower semi-continuous. We have that function f is lower semi-continuous if we have that lower limit, which exists always, of fx, again, at point x0, this more or equal than the value of the function fx0, okay? Now, the same definition, of course, we can write for upper semi-continuous function if we have that upper limit is more or less or equal than f of x0. So this is some generalization of continuity. Now, why this is interesting for us? For example, by the following arguments. This continuity of the function, now for some set, for the whole set, can be done in the following way. That function is continuous if and only if we understand with you that image of the function is not good to characterize this function. We can take very good, very continuous functions, sine x, yes? But the image of open set can be closed easily, easy to see, yes? Since we take this open set, that image of the set is open. But pre-image must be open. This is one of characterizations, one of definition of for continuity function, that we have the following. For any open set G, for any open G, the pre-image f minus 1 of G should be open, yeah? So, indeed, it can be considered as definition of open sets, or it is the same by complementary. For any closed set f, we have that f minus 1 of f is closed. Now, but what is open set? Open set, it is a union, finite or countable union of open intervals. Therefore, this definition, indeed, can be done in the following way. It is the same, that set is open. We have that we have that f minus 1 of minus infinity, or maybe it's better to write for any ab. Let's write for any ab. For any ab, the preimage of this interval ab is open. For any preimage of open interval is open. And since then it's not difficult to see that we can do this for any set. Now, we can use these arguments for the lower semi-continuous. I recommend you to prove this. I mean, for this lower semi-continuous, just from definition. We have that f is lower semi-continuous if and only if, this characterization. If for any real a, we have that pre-image of minus 1 of minus infinity a is open. This pre-image is open. Or it is the same for any a, the pre-image of minus this one of a infinity is closed. Okay? And the same type of characterization you can write for upper semi-continuous function. So we see with you that wait a minute. This is okay, but this is wrong since we have to take a infinity. I'm very sorry. We have to take a infinity for open and minus a infinity for closed. Yeah? So let's look. Yeah, if we take pre-image, yeah, a infinity is open and minus infinity a is closed. Yeah, so this one, of course. Yeah. Now, also for lower semi-continuous function, another characterization is lower semi-continuous if and only if there exists the sequence of continuous function such that we have that fn is the pointwise limit of this limit in pointwise sense. Again, it's not difficult to see on this picture. Of course, it's not the proof. So there are some characterizations. Now, some arguments that if you want to describe some functions from some class, we have to consider pre-images. Pre-images of the function, pre-images. The same stuff we will do for the bare functions, that is, we will consider with you pre-images of bare functions. Okay, I want to give you two theorems. The first theorem, the second indeed is generalization, of the first one. The first theorem is the following. We have that A, it is the maybe immediately let's consider the second, since otherwise we have to define all that stuff. For some reason, in logic, mathematical logic, they introduce special notations, sigma class and the pi class. This first sigma class, it will be just sigma, it is this, the same as zero, it will be just collection of open sets. Now, the second class, it will be F sigma. Now, the third class, it will be G delta sigma. That is, these pi classes, they will not be so important for us. It will be F, it will be G sigma, etc., etc. Now, G delta, etc., etc. Now, we understand how to do this. They will alternate. So this is F, and this will be sigma, delta sigma, etc., etc. So please look at this sequence of classes. Why these are interesting and important for us? By the following theorem. Some books attribute this theorem to Banach, Hausdorff, and Lebesgue. It's rather interesting, in my opinion, since these are three creators. The Banach is creator of functional analysis, Hausdorff of the theory of metric spaces, Lebesgue creator of measure theory. But this theorem is not about metric spaces, about the functional analysis and measure theory. This is just about Borel sets and bare functions. Okay? So this theorem says the following. Look, in this theorem, they do the following. Function f belongs to bare class alpha. Alpha, this is not number,
It's a cardinal, maybe less than omega 1. So we can take any cardinal from here, if and only if. If and only if. If and only if. We have that pre-image, look and compare with that one. Pre-image of, with respect to this function, for any open set, it is a set now, yes? It is a set. It belongs to this sigma alpha plus 1 for any open set. For any open set G. Okay, so let's look, please, at this theorem. So again, indeed, as I understand, the proof a kind of induction, but this is transfinite induction. So let's consider just this as a fact. Okay, we don't prove this; we will use it only. But let's consider some cases. First cases, some of them will be just immediately by definition, some of cases will be interesting for us. First of all, in particular, what do we have in particular? We can take the all union, we can consider all possible alpha, which are smaller than omega 1. And then we will have that function f belongs to Baer class. Yeah? For any, what is Baer? Baer, it is a union of all of them. Yeah? For all cardinals. In particular, we have that collection of all Baer, maybe it's better to write in that way, it's not quite good. In particular, f, it is Baer function, that is Baer function belongs to this hierarchy, if and only if, since if we take union, if we take union for all of them, of course we will have Borel sets. We will have that f minus 1 of g is Borel sets. It's Borel sets for any open set g. So this is the first conclusion of this theorem. Yes, in particular. So this is some relation. So this is a rather strict relation. Not only relation between Borel function, Borel sets and Baer functions, but we see some relation between corresponding classes. Between corresponding classes. Now let's look. Let's consider some trivial examples, the first values of alpha. Now, if alpha equals 1, indeed we can take alpha equals 0, why not? We can put here 0, by the way. If we put alpha 0, then what is written here? It's written here that function is continuous on the interval AB, if and only if, since Baer 0 plus continuous function, yeah? If and only if, pre-image of for this function of any open set is open. Yeah? Okay, we have this. If and only if f minus 1 of g is open. So we understand this. Now, f belongs to the class Baer 1 if and only if pre-image for any open set from where? From f sigma. From f sigma. Okay? Because of that line. Does that column f from Baer 2 if and only if this f minus 1 of g from g delta sigma now look please a kind of application let's consider function f which is Dirichlet function characteristic function of set of rational Dirichlet function so what is the f minus 1 of the following open set? So it is 0 of the set 1 over 2 infinity. 1 over 2 infinity. Pre-image. Pre-image. So we have, let on the interval 0, 1. We have at rational points it is 1. At rational points it is 0. And we consider pre-image for 1 over 2 infinity. Set of rational, yes? We have that this set of rational. But this set of rational is not G delta. It's not G delta. So maybe it's better to take another one, so it's not good. I want to take F. So let's take pre-image for minus infinity 1 over 2. Now it is set of rational pre-image. Yes? We have this set, pre-image set of irrational. The set of irrational is not f sigma, as we discussed with you at the beginning. Yeah? It's not f sigma. What is the conclusion? But it is set of irrational definitely from g delta sigma. It's easy to represent explicitly. Therefore, from here we have that this Dirichlet function is not from bear one class. Is not from bear one class. It is belongs to bear two class, but it does not belong to the class bear one. Bear one. Of course, it's not strange, but of course all these embeddings are strict. Yeah. So this is just example that this embedding is strict. So bear two is strictly larger than this bear one. Okay, I will finish in a few seconds. Ah, by the way, it's very useful exercise. I will give you maybe in the second homework to show explicitly, that this function is from bear two class. There is. What does it mean? It means to construct sequence of functions such that any of this function is the pointwise limit of continuous function for another sequence. Yes. And this sequence converges pointwisely to set of rational. That is, it's impossible to represent this function as pointwise limit of sequence of continuous function. Yes? Only we can approximate by pointwise limit of some sequence, and any element of the sequence is itself pointwise limit for continuous functions. Okay, there are two other results that I'm going to consider with you next time. And then eventually we will start to consider measures. So till now, some results about the structure of the line, etc. Please ask questions. Ah, now I hope you are more or less ready to solve almost all problems from the first homework. But once more, I'm ready to give you hints or ideas what to do, especially maybe for first one. Okay. Thank you. See you next time.